another Behold the Lamb Presents program. Today's message is the second in a series of five we've entitled Addressing the Power of the Holy Spirit. In the first of this five series of sermons, we discovered that yes, our churches do need more Holy Spirit power. We need God's Spirit in abundance if we are to ever finish the work that He has given us of proclaiming the gospel to a lost and dying world. But in order for our churches to obtain this power, we must first examine ourselves. We have to want that power. We must desire to so order our lives that the Holy Spirit will find a home, a body temple in which to dwell. Therefore, today's message is entitled, You Have to Want That Power. You have to want that power. So begin today to pray, study, and asking God for His outpouring. Friends, only then will our Heavenly Father be able to convict and strengthen us to overcome our worldly character defects. Only then will the gospel of salvation truly become alive in your hearts. And only then will the Bible become the truth that will set us free from the enemy's snares of sin. But first, let us visit 3ABN's Worship Center and richly be blessed by a song properly entitled, My Help. It is sung by our friend in Christ, Lyndon Carriger.
From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord who made heaven and earth. He said, He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord which keepeth thee, He will not slumber nor sleep. For the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade. Upon thy right hand, upon thy right hand. No, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. He shall preserve thy soul. Cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord who made heaven and earth. He said, He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord which keepeth thee, He will not slumber nor sleep.
Thank you for joining us today, wherever you may be around the world. And thank you, Lyndon, for that beautiful song. I know it was a blessing. We're glad that you've joined us. But you know, before we do our Bible study today, and we are doing an exciting subject, and I know that you want to be a part of it. Before we always get into the Word of God, we take time to pray. So let's do that right now. You can kneel if you're home or wherever you might be where you can. Won't you kneel with me and let's pray for God's blessing, shall we? Merciful Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege we have to serve you today. We ask that you would send your Holy Spirit to give us proper understanding of your word. Now we ask that the things of earth will grow strangely dim as we spend this time with thee. We pray that our relationship with you will improve day by day as we continue to dig in the word and find these beautiful truths. We ask that you would bless each and every one who listens, who views around the world, that hearts and lives will be changed for eternity is my prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, again, we're glad that you joined us. We've been doing, started last time, a five-part series on the Holy Spirit. And we've been talking about, does the church, this is a series, does the church need more power? We came to grips, by the way, that first of all, unless we recognize that we need more power, that we're not going to do anything about it. And as we studied the lesson, I think all of us came into agreement that we need more of the activating power of the Holy Spirit inside the church and inside of our individual lives. And so as we studied that, I'm sure that each one of you got a little better grip on how God would use you to help finish the work and the necessity of having power from on high. Today, by the way, our subject we're going to be talking about, you have to want that power. Now, first it was what? Oh, yeah, does the church need more power? Yes. Now, but you have to want that power. Do you realize there's many people in the church that says, oh, I'd like to have Holy Spirit power, but they do nothing about it. They don't even desire it in their life. Oh, but once we begin to see the importance of the power of the Spirit in our life and how that we can accomplish nothing without it, I believe that you're going to desire that too. I desire that power. I want to see that power operating inside the church and inside of our individual lives. So we've seen, as we've been studying, that we need to pray for this power. By the way, sometimes it's down to fasting and prayer. But we're going to really be seeking for this Holy Spirit power. We're going to be saying today in our study that, Lord, I need that power. I want that power in my life. It's a necessity if I'm going to be what Jesus wants me to be. And by the way, what might be the results? Think about it. What might be the result if we really ask the Holy Spirit to come directly into our hearts and to our lives and we let the things of the earth go? You realize what would take place in your life and in mine? By the way, it may be a conversion for you. It may be a conversion for me. And by the way, there will be people that will be converted to the truth because of the Spirit that lives and dwells in you. And by the way, I want that in my life. And you know what we'll see? In the church, I've had people say, well, we don't see things happening in the church. Well, why not? When the church is filled with Holy Spirit power, the Bible said there's miracles and signs and there's wonders and answers to prayer. Oh, friend, don't be afraid to pray for Holy Spirit power. And by the way, when we pray for that power, you know, we need to be praying for our family and our loved ones and those who maybe are outside the ark of safety, that the Spirit of God will work upon them. As my mother always used to say, they give no rest day or night until they accept Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. Well, if we got down on our knees and asked for that kind of power, boy, what would happen? And you know, as I've been reading Scripture, the Bible says that the Spirit is going to be poured out upon us. Poured where? Poured out upon us. We talked about before, not a little sprinkle here and there, but we're going to be saturated with the power of the Holy Spirit. Poured out. The Bible says, open the windows of heaven, and there's going to be Holy Spirit power poured out on us. We talk about it all the time, but are we seeing it in action? I pray that you are, and I pray that you know each one of us are spending some more time in the Word. Because you know what? I want to be filled completely with the power of heaven. Heaven wants to bestow it on me. Now, as we study this message, it's clear that we need it. It's clear now that as we're studying here that we have to desire this kind of power. Now, By the way, for those of you who maybe didn't get to view that first part, let me just kind of fill you in just a little bit here. And filling in is simply is that we must, what, recognize when we're maybe weak in an area, recognize that we have a problem before it can ever be fixed. And so as we recognize it, we say, okay, Lord, we want it. We need this more power. But it's a power that we talked about that comes from what? Not within us, but a power that's outside of us that we're going to invite into us to totally take control of your life. What kind of an individual would you be? What kind of individual would I be? What would the church be if we allowed the Spirit of God to really come in and take control of us? Friend, we can find the answers to these questions because God wants to bestow it upon His church. And by the way, that power, when it comes, is going to come straight from the throne room of God. And again, I'm not asking for a sprinkling today. I'm asking for what? I want to be bathed in it. And I know that you do too. It's essential. But here's the thing. Here's a question for you. Now, I want you to think with me. Those of you, you need to write some things down because you're going to forget, bless your heart. Are there conditions on receiving Holy Spirit power? Are there any conditions? And I think probably most of our first answer would be, oh, yes, I know there are conditions. But let me give you one of the, what I think is one of the main conditions upon receiving the power of the Spirit, but one that majority of Christians reject. You have your Bible. I want you to turn with me the New Testament to the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 5, verse 32, I want you to think about this here. Now remember, the Bible says, and when the Bible says, that's what you and I are to believe. By faith, we believe what the Bible said. Listen, no, don't add to it, don't subtract, but just simply read it and by faith accept it as the Holy Spirit has brought it to us. Here's what my Bible says. If you're talking Holy Spirit, and by the way, I see many Christians who never quote this passage of Scripture. They deal with feelings and emotions and all other kind of things. But my Bible says this. The Holy Spirit is given to those who, oh, I heard somebody. That what? That obey Him. That's what Acts 5:32 says. The Holy Spirit then, the Bible says, is given to those, listen, who submit themselves to God. The Holy Spirit is given to those who, by the way, want to put Him first in their life. The Holy Spirit is given to those who conform. That's what that word obey. Those who obey, those who conform, those who submit, those who are willing to put Him first in their life. Now remember, keep this as the basis of what we're building on today. Please do that. You have to let everything else go. I've had people call and say, well, you know, I felt a certain thing. That's wonderful. God gives us feelings. He's the author of our emotions and so on, but we have to keep them in check based upon what? Based upon the Word of God. We can't get away from that. I've actually had, this takes nerve, by the way, and I don't mind challenging some of the Christians if you're one of those today because I want you to think. If you're one of those who read the Scripture and you say, I know what it says, but, you're in trouble. You're in trouble. I know what it says, but. That means what? But I felt. I sensed. I seen. Oh, you can't trust your eyes. You can't trust your senses. The heart is, what, deceitful? Isn't above all things? It's desperately, the Bible said, wicked. Who can know it? So the firm foundation that we have is Scripture. So the power of the Spirit, this is no exceptions to it. The Spirit, Holy Spirit is given to those who obey, not disobey. That's what the Bible says. And, you know, by the way, we're talking about these conditions of receiving this Holy Spirit power and obeying God's Word. In fact, how much of God's Word must we obey? Oh, the Bible is very clear, maybe elementary to some, but Matthew chapter 4, verse 4 says, every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. How many? Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Well, that's interesting. That's exciting. Every word. Do you remember what Peter says? And by the way, this is also found in Acts chapter 5, verse 29. It said, Peter and the other disciples, listen carefully, and the other disciples said, notice this, we ought to obey God rather than men. They came to this conclusion. They weren't interested in what men are saying. By the way, they wasn't interested in what, you know, what criteria man might operate upon. They were interested in what the Holy Spirit, what Scripture told them to do. This is what way we have to come to grips with God's Word today. We ought to obey God rather than men. And by the way, do you remember? Let's do this quickly because I think it's very interesting we talk about obedience. Because again, as soon as you mention the word obedience to some Christians, what is it? The wall goes up. Oh, we don't have to worry about being obedient. We don't have to. Remember, Holy Spirit is given to those that what? That obey. So if you're disobeying the Word of God, every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, you have not received the Holy Spirit. There may be a Spirit leading in your life, and it may seem like, oh, but it's not. The fruits will tell otherwise. Because the Bible is clear on we have to obey Him. In 1 Samuel 15, 22, the Bible was talking, it was very interesting. It said, it's better to obey than what? Than sacrifice. And it's interesting when you look up 1 Samuel, by the way, 15, 22, and begin to dig a little bit in the Word, a little here and there a little for the truth, remember, is that Jesus was talking a little deeper. He was speaking a little deeper through His Spirit. Now notice that. It's better here, she said, to obey than to sacrifice. It was talking about ceremony, you know, that was taking place in the earthly sanctuary. But also we're talking about sacrifice here was but what? Giving. We must include that in this passage. Jesus says, what good will it do if we're willing to give? We're sacrificing, we're taking our finances and we're giving and we're doing when the heart is not changed, when we're living in disobedience to God's laws. He said, I don't need what you have. Why doesn't God need what you have? Why? Because He owns it all. Bible says He owns a cattle on, what, 1,000 hills? And so He says that rather than you sacrifice or give some of the things that I've already given to you, just give me your heart. If we want that power, if you said in your heart, you know, I want this kind of power in my life. I want to be God's companion. I want to be filled with this kind of power in our life. Then we need to look at some of these passages. By the way, in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9, the Bible is clear, listen carefully, that salvation is given to those who obey Him. Conditional, did you see? Receiving that kind of power, there are what? There are conditions. And when I'm talking about the most important condition has to do with what? The Bible says salvation. Salvation is given to those that do what? That obey Him is what Scripture tells me. And when you talk about obey, that means salvation is given to those, listen, who consent to the Word of God. Salvation is given to those who, listen carefully, the word here means to give ear to the Word of God. Those who heed the Word of God. Notice that. And by the way, we look at it, that word is what? It's conditional. Salvation is conditional upon our being obedient. Oh, as much as we don't want to hear that, and much as we detest that, think about it. Think about it with me right now. No. Think about it. Some of you are not thinking with me. Salvation is what? It depends on our being obedient to God. And by the way, the book of Matthew says in 8:27, this was very interesting. The Bible said, you know, you had disciples going out and different people going in different places, and the Sadducees and the Pharisees and so on and so forth. And you know, when Jesus walked the earth, everything in nature even obeyed Him. And then in Mark 8:27, it says, they looked around and said, "Whoa, what kind of a man is this? What kind of a man is this that even the wind and the sea obey Him?" Ah, He asked for our obedience. Nature obeys Him. The people walking the earth want to know, what kind of a man is this right here? Everything that the sea, the winds obey his voice. Oh, friend. And by the way, when you're still studying here and you got your Bible and you're jotting things down in the book of Mark 1:27, this is powerful. It said, even the unclean spirits, they do obey him. Think about what Jesus is saying. If we have Holy Spirit power in life, and you really want that power in your life, dear friends, you will have power over the devil. You're going to have power over the unclean spirits. You say, well, I don't know. Jesus did. Jesus said things that he did. What? Greater things will you do. If you're filled, he was just filled with the Father. He was filled with Holy Spirit power. We need not worry about the demons from hell, do we? Not when Jesus, right, is filling our minds and our heart. Jeremiah 7:23, you go to the Old Testament, and it says, if you obey my voice, notice this, I will be your God. Oh, that's beautiful. If you do what? If you obey, I will be what? Your God. The unclean spirits, they obey him. The sea and the winds, they obey him. Salvation depends upon what? Our obedience to him. To obey is better than to sacrifice, the Bible says. We ought to obey God rather than men. That word obey, you cannot throw it out. There's something about obedience is what the Bible says. And then we switch back, by the way, to the New Testament, to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 2, verse 16. It says, his servants are ye, or those who obey him. So if we're servants of the Most High, then we are what? We're going to be obedient to what he asks us to do. Oh, friend, think on this for a moment. You know, I often say it many, many times. I love to sometimes punch pretty hard. It's not me doing the punching. It's the Word of God. And I want to bring it so close to home that you're going to take it serious. What I'm talking about today is life and death issue. We recognize we need the power, right, in our first part. Second part, right, of our series here is we have to desire that. We have to want that power. We have to desire that power. Do you want that power? Before you want it, you have to recognize, realize that you need it. But I want you to think on this for a moment. Let me just throw you a little bomb. And I'm going to include every man, every woman, every child that is not under the control, notice this, of the Spirit of God, is under the influence of Satan and his power. Did you get that? Oh, friend, I want you to get that. That rings in my mind today. I pray that it's ringing in your mind. Every man, woman, and child not under the what? The control of the Spirit of God is underneath what? The influence of the devil's power. It's one or the other. You're either totally committed or you're not. You either are or you aren't. This is heavy duty. Could it fool some of us? Could some of us be fooled? Thinking, wow. What do you mean under the power of the devil? You know what the devil will do when we get underneath his influence? He's going to lead you away from truth. Well, how would he lead me away from truth? How would he lead others away from truth? Dear friends, you will lead them astray by your words and by your example. You're going to lead them away by your example. Now, by the way, if this is your case today, let me just talk to you. You know what? I need to be talking to everybody. I'm talking to myself here today. If this be the case, if somehow we've slipped on that side of the enemy there, why not? Why not? Why not change the one that you've been hanging out with? Why not change your companionship, notice the word, from the enemy to the companionship of Jesus Christ? Do you see how that really kind of gets together and maybe gets a little heated for us at time, and we're just saying, wait a minute here, but I'm talking about companionship means that you spend some time together, doesn't it? Means you're pretty close together. Sometime you're either a companion with the devil or you're a companion with Jesus Christ. Which is it today? I invite you to take Christ as your companion. You can do that right now. Because the book of Matthew chapter 12, verse 30 says, and I've quoted this often, and it is so true always, he who is not with me is against me. Absolutely. You're either for him or against him today. There is no middle ground. So I can only plead with you. You need this power. You desire, want this power. This is our only hope in the Christian movement in our individual life. We must want that power. Oh, I love the Old Testament, the book of Psalms 37, verse 4. It says, delight thyself also in the Lord, and he will give thee the desires of thy heart. But notice, he'll give you the desires of your heart if you do what? Good. If you delight. Friend, are you delighting in the Lord today? Is he your delight? Do you wake up thinking about him? Do you go to bed thinking about him? Do you want your life to be like him? You want him to fully reproduce, right, his image inside of you. Remember what it's talking about here. Delight thyself in the Lord. That means, are we really earnestly seeking him? If you're earnestly seeking him, he's going to give you that desire that you have. See, there's too many people in the world today, by the way, I desire a nice home. I desire a new car. I desire a job. I desire a mate. I desire things of this world. Jesus said, I'm going to give you the desires of your heart. That means, how about the request? Be careful what we pray for. He said, I'll give you the request, right, of your heart, the petitions of your heart. Where are they today? What are you really praying about in your life today? What are you really earnestly seeking today? Is it a closer walk with Jesus? And are you doing it by, listen carefully, two things, fasting and prayer. When you really get serious with God, you're going to spend some time. My mother, many years ago, she used to sing a song, you know, how long has it been since you knelt by your bed and prayed to the Lord in secret? You know, how long has it been, you know, since we knelt there and we prayed? Maybe all night long and until the dawn came up. Oh, by nighttime, usually most of them were tired, you're worn out, and you say, oh, Lord, bless the family, and that's it. When you really desire something, you're going to spend some time, you're going to be praying, you're going to say, God, I'm going to fast so that my mind can be clear to behold the things of God. I want to be filled with that Spirit. And by the way, this story told about a man, and it was an American and an Englishman. One to come over in the country to visit, and they were viewing the Niagara Falls and what they would really call the Whirlpool Rapids. And so both the men were standing there and they were kind of viewing the overall picture there and thought, boy, this is really good. And one of the men elbowed the other and said, look, I'm going to show you something. I'm going to show you the greatest unused power in the world. And so they made their way down to the foot or the bottom of Niagara. And there the man pointed down and said, look, this is the greatest unused power in the world. The other man looked at him and said, oh, my brother, not so. Well, it confused the man for a moment. What do you mean, not so? Is there another fall? Is there something that's greater than this? Ah, not so, my brother. The greatest unused power in the world is the Holy Spirit of the living God. Oh, how sad. The greatest unused power in the world is the Holy Spirit. And it's there for us. Not using the Holy Spirit, but letting the Holy Spirit use us. Why don't we let that happen in our life? All these little difficulties and these things will be smoothed out. God will use us to win souls. Let's tap into that power. By the way, Zechariah 4:6, and oh, I know most of you know this. The Bible says, not by what? might nor by power, but by thy Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. So it's not by what? Not by might. It's not by power in the world. Well, I'm going to do this. I've got this here. I've got money. I've got power. I've got clout. You know, I've got the clout, they call it. I've got power in the world. And the Bible comes back and says it's not by man's might, not by his power, not by his position, not by his finances, not by his education, but that power comes from none other than the Holy Spirit. Friend, we need it in our life. We need to desire it, that we have it in our life. Oh, God, help us. Reading one of my favorite books called The Great Controversy in page 528 and 529. I'm going to read part of that to you, and I want you to listen to it. This is so important to those of you who are struggling every day to live the victorious life and what's available to us. Oh, please don't miss this right here. Take your pencil or your paper, put it down right now. Please write it down and say, look, I'm going to go back and study this out. This is encouragement to me. It says, neither wicked men nor devils, neither wicked men nor devils can hinder the work of God. That makes me want to shout, and I just might do it. Neither what? Oh, the wicked men nor devils can hinder the work of God. Oh, look, the devil slowed us down again. Oh, the devil done. Hey, I've been saying that myself a lot. We know he's active, but remember, he cannot, didn't say stop it, he can't even hinder the work of God. That's powerful. Or he can't shut out the presence, reading on, his presence from his people. He can't shut God's presence away from us. Isn't that wonderful to know? We need that. Notice, and then here comes this thing, if. Oh, some of us don't want to hear about this if. But if today, if you're saying right now, I tell you, we're working for Jesus, and I tell you, it seems like we're being stopped everywhere which we go. Say, look, no wicked man, no devil can hinder the work of God. No devil can shut the power of God away from me. Principalities and powers, you remember it. But then if comes in. Oh, why does the if? The article goes on to say, if they will with subdued. Get it? What is this talking about? Subdued. That means if I will subject myself. Under subjection to the Holy Spirit. I need to soften. I need to submit. Notice this, I submit by training. I must be willing to submit myself to the power of the Holy Spirit to retrain me if necessary. I have to have that kind of heart that's willing to be taught. Then no devil can stop us from doing what needs to be done for Jesus. And it simply means here when you're talking about subdued, that means, listen, some of you, stop fighting God. It's a losing battle. You can't fight God. You can't win a battle. Have you ever thought just a moment about that? Like, oh, fighting God. Well, you know, if I don't want to do this, I'm not going to have to do that. You realize who you're talking to if you're addressing God of the universe? Friend, you are nothing and I am nothing in this world. But God thinks that we are, and I praise Him for that. That Jesus is willing to come and die for us. But never stand in the face of God. Never challenge God. Best thing for you and I, we want power of the Spirit, power to win souls, power to do something for Jesus, is to submit ourselves to Him, to be approachable, to be teachable, to be loving, and to be kind. Notice, the article goes on, and it says here that we need to be subdued and contrite. Think about this. This simply is, once again, it means humble, doesn't it? It also means what? Remorse. It means sorrow. So if we come and we confess our sins, if we're really sorry about things, if we get our life right with God, something's going to happen in our heart. And the article goes on and says, if we confess, notice this is very important. If we confess and put away our sins. Now remember, I talked about this if you want that power that the wicked men or devils can't stop. And by the way, sometime in the church, we have people trying to stop the movement of God. They can't do it either, but they try it. The wicked men or the devils can't stop it. They can't shut out God from us. They can't stop God's blessings. And yet sometimes we think they've stopped this blessing. No, they can't stop it. God may work in another channel, another avenue, and go around, whatever, but God will have His way as an end result. But so we need to confess and put away our sins in faith, notice this, and claim His promises, notice this. If we do this, this is where it's at. This is what's happening. I'm telling you, dear friends, what needs to happen in the church. We must pay attention to what we're talking about here. We're going to put away, confess, and put away sins. Then it goes on, in faith, claim promises, notice this, His promises, and every temptation, every what? Didn't say every other one, but it said every temptation, every opposing influence, whether open or secret, will be successfully resisted. You want to gain victory through the power of the Holy Spirit? There are conditions. We confess our sins here and we turn from those things. We claim His promises. Every temptation. Think about it. Every opposing influence. And oh, there's so many opposing influences in the world today. So many things out to try to stop the cause of God. And it says here, whether open, whether we realize it or not, or whether these opposing things are in secret, it's clear that they may be successfully resisted through the power of the Spirit of God, because He said, I will fight your battles for you. You see, this is exciting. Why is there so much defeat, so much sorrow, so much gloom and doom? And again, I say defeat over and over in the movement of God is because we are not claiming the promises of God. We're not coming to Him with a contrite heart. We're not coming to Him with a subdued heart. We're not willing to be taught. We're not willing to change our life. We're not willing to come to Him and say, God, whatever it takes. Oh, friend, as you read the promises of God, oh, go immediately to the throne room. Don't wait till the evening. Go to the throne room boldly because of who He is. Run out to the highways and the byways and tell other people. They say, well, I can't resist this temptation. Oh, this thing overtakes me every time. Doesn't have to. You never have to be defeated. It's a choice. You can choose God. You can choose His companionship. And that Holy Spirit, dear friends, I'm telling you, is coming in great measure. I sense it now. I see it in people's lives. And God said this work is going to end with greater manifestation than in the beginning. It's what we're studying here. Oh, this is awesome to me. In fact, by the way, you still have your Bible out. Keep it going. We've got a little bit of time left here. I want this to be such an encouragement to you that you know. You exercise faith to know that God's going to fill you with that Spirit. God's going to use you for His honor and for His glory. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verse 21, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. See, that's a promise. It doesn't give a whole lot of do's and don'ts and so on and so forth, but it starts out like this. If you call upon the name of the Lord, when you call upon the name of the Lord, you're ready for a change in your life. Some of you are too proud. Some of you are too just stiff-necked. Some of you don't want that really to change, but yet in your heart you kind of do. You don't know what to do, where to go, and so you do nothing. Oh, friend, I encourage you, get up, do something. Do something, and God's going to direct your path because He promised to. Call upon the name of the Lord, and the Bible says you shall be what? You shall be saved. This is what it's about. You say, well, I'm not so sure. Listen, if you're looking at that Bible in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. Listen to these precious little words. We're talking about God here, who would have all men to be saved. Oh, friend, God's desire for you today, right now, this moment, He wants to save you. That's what the Bible says. God's desire is to what? Is for all men to be saved. This is what He wants. This is what He's enabling us to do through His merits and through His strength and through His, what? The cross of Calvary. It's yours. It's mine. 1 Corinthians 15, by the way, verses 1 and 2. As we continue to cry out for this power, recognizing that we need it and that we want it in our life, notice this passage. It says, moreover, and Paul speaking, moreover, my brethren, I declare unto you the gospel. Friend, sometimes we forget that beautiful gospel of Jesus Christ. He said, the gospel that I preached unto you. It's a good example. We need to be preaching Jesus Christ and Him crucified. He says, which you have also received and wherein ye stand. Verse 2 says, notice, by which also ye are saved. Notice the word. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. I thought, how exciting that is. Passage of Scripture sometime that we read and then we just like, oh, well, okay, well, I think I've got the point. Oh, study. Get down in and begin to dig a little bit deeper. Paul points out the importance of what? Of the gospel that he gave to them. And he said, now that remember, the gospel is so important. He said, you believed it and then you stand in it and then you're going to be saved in it. The gospel must be preached into all the world as a witness, and then Jesus is going to come. But we're going to have to stand in this thing. Oh, friend, it's so important today. It's so important that we accept Jesus, that this gospel is preached to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. And by the way, the gospel, you know what I call the gospel? It's a good news. You like good news? That's a gospel. We need that gospel. In that good news, there's so many things involved. Salvation. Righteousness by faith. In the gospel, we realize that Jesus came and He lived and He lived that victorious life. And He died, He was buried, but He rose again. Part of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We read Scripture and says He sits on the what? On the right hand of the Father. He's a mediator of a better covenant. He's our high priest. And He promises to come again. This is something. This is the gospel. People need to know that Jesus is coming back. We need to know that we have a mediator. We have to know that we have help in our time of need. We need to know that one stands between us and the Father and pleads His blood. Friends, that's good news. We need to. Six Testimonies 291, by the way. Another little book. I'm gleaning some beautiful things out of it, and I hope you've been studying too. Keep it up. It says, the truth for this time embraces the whole gospel. The truth for this time embraces what? The whole gospel. What is that whole gospel? Now, rightly presented, it will make evident the power of God's grace. Do you need more power? Do you want that power? You're desiring it today? It deals with what? The gospel. The plan of salvation here upon the heart. It said it will do a complete work and develop a complete man. Friend, you realize we need to be complete in Jesus Christ. Complete in Him. That's the plan that God has for us. If you don't believe that, read with me in Colossians chapter 4, verse 12. He says, we're going to be perfect and complete in all the will of God. What? Perfect and complete in all the will of God. So we have no excuse. You say, well, I don't know about being perfect in Him. The Bible says, first the blade, then the ear, then the full corn. In every stage, it's perfection. Even though I haven't reached to the full corn, we can still be living up to the light that God has given. We can be praying for that power that God wants to give us. In order to develop that complete man, we have to die daily. Friend, are you willing to die daily to yourself? The biggest battle that you're going to ever fight is yourself. Quit blaming the preacher. Quit blaming the church. Quit blaming one another. Look at yourself. Look in the mirror. There's your problem. Here's my problem. Every sin traces back to I want. I need. You remember the devil said, I will ascend. Do you remember that? I will be like the Most High. Today we use some of the same words, same thoughts. They're from the enemy, aren't they? But Jesus said, no, Kenny, you're going to have to die daily. 1 Corinthians 15:31. You don't have time to go into it, but you read that when you have the opportunity, because it talks about we need to die daily. Standing. Bible says we have to stand in the Word. We have to receive the Word. If you want the Spirit and you say, I need that Spirit, then we must be willing to receive that Word. Now think about it. You have your Bibles. I want you to turn. We still have a few minutes left. And I want you to turn to the Old Testament. This is very, very important here. In the Old Testament, we're going to look at Proverbs chapter 2. I want to do this from my Bible. I want to read this because I don't want you to miss it. Proverbs chapter 2. Listen, this is dynamite. If you miss this, you've missed the whole program. This will tell you exactly how you can receive the power of that Holy Spirit and that desire in your heart that you want it. Don't miss this. Proverbs chapter 2, I'm going to start reading verses 1 through 5. Notice what the Bible says. It said, "My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom," notice this, "and apply thy heart to understanding, yea, if thou criest after knowledge, lifteth up thy voice for understanding, if thou seeketh her as silver," the Bible says, "search for her as for hid treasures, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God." You see how important what is listed in here? If we had a whole lot more time, we could do it. Just go back and start picking out the most important words. Let's do that just quickly as we can. I'd love to look up passages on every one of these. I've got them up here. Don't have time to present them, but notice the Bible says here that we need to first do what? Receive His Word. We quoted Matthew 4:4, remember? Receive what? Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Do you remember that? You'll say, "Well, yeah, that's the Word. You mean that the written Word?" Oh! John chapter 1. You remember verse 1? In the beginning was what? Good. The Word, right? The Word was made flesh, right? And dwelt among men. Is that it? The Word Jesus Christ. Friend, have you accepted Him? Have you accepted Him? He is the Word. He's life. So we must do what? Receive. You have to receive His Word if you want this real power. Are you receiving the Word of God today? And here it says here that we have to hide the commandments within what? Within our hearts. I mean, you're already close by, so let me just do that. Show in Psalms 119. Psalms 119:11. Oh, this is powerful. Psalms 119:11. It says, "Thy word have I," what? Good. "Hid in my heart that I might not do," what? "I might not sin against thee." So we hide the word of God where? In our heart. Remember, there are conditions upon receiving the outpouring of the Holy Spirit without being led by the Spirit. And we have to be able to receive His word. And He said, I hide the word of God where? In my heart. I put His commandments in my heart. Oh, friend, if we had time, we'd read a lot more. But, you know, it says also in that we read that you have to incline your ear. You have to be willing to listen to the Word of God. Think about it. Willing to do what? To take your ears and listen to the Word of God. You'll say, "Well, I'm not sure of that." I'm going to put my finger right here and I'm going to turn to the book of Romans. I want you to do the same thing while you're there. In the book of Romans, I believe it's chapter 10, verse 17. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. The Bible says, "So faith cometh by what? Hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." You see how important it is that we incline our ear? Incline our ear to what? God said He wants us to have what? Wisdom. And we need to apply our hearts to understanding the Bible. All this I'm talking about here, we just read in Proverbs 2, 1 through 5. But these are conditions in order to receive that victory, in order to receive that power, to get the church on the move the way that it needs to be on the move today. We need to apply our heart to what? To understanding, the Bible said, Proverbs 3:5. Read that when you get an opportunity. We need to seek the Word as for a hidden treasure, the Bible says. Notice that. And it says, this is the fear of God. By the way, three angels' message, isn't it? Fear God and give glory to Him. For the hour of His judgment is come. Fear God. This is the fear of God. Friend, we live in such an hour that we need to realize that Jesus is coming. We need to be making the changes that we need to be making. We need to be making them today, not later on. And so the Bible says that we need to receive it. And we need to stand in it. Friend, how long has it been since you've been standing in the Word? I like that song says, "Standing on the promises of God." How about you? Oh, I'm standing on those promises. I like the song that says, stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. God never asked us to be seated as a Christian. He always said, stand, get up on your feet, get ready to move. By the way, Romans 11:20 says, we stand by what? We stand by faith. Did you notice that? Galatians 5:1 says, stand fast, therefore, in what? Liberty. Notice the word talking about standing. Ephesians 6:11, the Bible says, stand against the wiles of the devil. Fight him. Stand against the wiles of what? Against the wiles of the devil. Colossians 4:12, that ye may stand perfect and complete in him. Romans 15, verse 2, stand. One of these days we're going to be able to stand on the what? On the sea of glass. Colossians 1, by the way, 23 says, if you what? Condition. If you continue in the faith, grounded and settled. We have very few people seem to be grounded and settled in the truth anymore. It's wishy-washy. It's blown by every wind of doctrine. Because we do not know the Word of God, we shall not be moved away from the hope of the gospel which you've heard. Friend, I'm telling you, this is an hour in which we live. God says, you know what? I want people with sound minds. I want people who have sound words. I want you to be sound in the faith. I want you to have sound speech, the Bible says. And to have this sound mind is in Philippians 2:5, is to what? Is to have the mind of Jesus Christ. We live in a crooked and perverse world, by the way, but we need to hold fast to the Word of God right now. Why? Because we're looking for Jesus to come. He's the author and finisher, by the way, of our faith. I need to be exceedingly glad. I need to delight in His Word. I need to be living for Him, doing something for Jesus. And let me encourage you, as you commit your soul to Jesus right now, you commit your life to Him right now, there's going to be a power that comes over you that maybe you've never experienced before. Why? Because you can have a powerful influence as you let Jesus come in, the power of God. That spirit of power will convict your soul, enable you to lead other souls to Jesus Christ, to be a soul winner. This is what it's all about. By the way, don't wait until it's too late. Don't wait till the last moment. Let me just share a little small story with you. I think it's so very, very important. And some of you will relate to this and others you won't get it. But, you know, there's a great baseball player. His name was Ty Cobb. And, man, what a ball player he was. He played over 3,000 games, by the way. And for 12 years, he led the American League in batting average. And for four of those years, listen, he batted over 400. That's amazing. But on his deathbed, it was July the 17th in 1961. This man of baseball that people in the sports world followed after him and said how a great man that he was, on his deathbed, he accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. But please take note of these words. He said, tell the boys I'm sorry. Tell the boys I'm sorry. It was the last part of the ninth inning that I came to know Christ. Oh, I wished it had been taken place in the first half of the first inning. Friend, don't let that be said about you. Look at all that you can do for Jesus. If you're filled with that power, if you desire that power in your life, don't wait till the deathbed. Why not make that decision and that choice right now for Him? Please do that right now. He wants to use you. Say, God, I want this power. I need this power. And you know what? You're going to send that power to them. All they have to do is ask right now in the name of Jesus, and it's going to be so. By the way, for those of you who are making that decision right now, why don't we pray about it in our last few moments that we have right here? Don't delay. And by the way, when you make that decision, it'd be nice to let us know that we can rejoice along with you. Let's just have a prayer right now that we can come together in Jesus, that right now you've recognized there's a need for this Holy Spirit power. Now you're calling on that power to come into your heart, into your life, and watch what God's going to do. Let's pray, shall we, together. Merciful Father in heaven, we thank you for your precious word today. We pray now, as there have been many around the world right now is giving their life anew, afresh to Jesus Christ. They want to receive that power. They see the importance of it to be a soul winner, to be victorious I pray you'll shower them with that power right now, now in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who would have all men to be saved in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, until next time, I'm going to encourage you to be sure and study your Bible. And when we come together, we've got another important study. I'll see you then.
Friends, hello again. It is our prayer that you were truly blessed and encouraged by today's message. Again, this was the second in a five-part series that we've entitled Addressing the Power of the Holy Spirit. There are three more in this series to look forward to. The next is preparation to receive that power, followed by how we receive that power. We need to know how to receive the power of God. And finally, witnessing with power. Don't you want to be a witness for Jesus? And you want to witness with the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, we can know all truth, we can say all the right things, but without God's Spirit to bless and to give power to that message, it can avail nothing. And should you or a loved one appreciate having this complete set to view time and time again, would you simply contact us and request the series Addressing the Power of the Holy Spirit? We will be happy to send this to you for a love gift of $35 or more. You can write us at Behold the Lamb Ministries. That's P.O. Box 2030, Heron, Illinois, 62948, or call area code 618-942-5044. That's American Central Standard Time. Email us at Behold the Lamb Ministries. I know it's a long name, but Behold the Lamb Ministries at yahoo.com, or you can visit us on the web at beholdthelambministries.com. Friends, we love you. We appreciate you. Until next time, may the Lord continue to richly bless you and yours.